Reporter Michelle Beventure is outside our new building to give you all the behind-the-scenes access. Hi there.
Hi, Monica. 6ABC has been the number one TV news station in Philadelphia for decades. I had the chance to spend the day at their brand new building, trying to figure out how everything works. What does it take to be number one? A lot.
I'm here in Love Park, where city workers are rallying for their new contract. Their previous contract expired last July. They'll be marching around City Hall, hoping to grab the attention of the mayor. Police still haven't located Daniel Hodgins, the suspect in the robbery of this Republic First Bank. If you have any information of his whereabouts, please contact the FBI or Philadelphia Police.
Inbound and outbound trains are running but 30-minute delays.
World Series fans made it home from the ballpark Monday night, but woke up to a troublesome surprise Tuesday morning.
I got to the train station this morning and I saw it in the Inquirer that there was a SEPTA strike, and all the trains were really late, and mine was very late.
My roommate sent me a text this morning to let me know, because he knew I had a midterm, so to like give myself a lot of extra time.
SEPTA's largest union, Local 234, went on strike at 3 a.m. this morning over contract negotiations with the city. The union has been without contracts since March and wants better pensions, guaranteed job security, and increased wages. Transport Workers Union leader Willie Brown said, quote, "This is not just a fight for us. It's a fight for working class people." The strike was postponed from 6 p.m. Saturday evening to this morning, so the World Series traffic would not be affected. But what about the more than 800,000 people who rely on SEPTA to get to work and school every day?
On foot, man. These good old Pumas, man. You know, say no. But on foot, I mean, I ain't know nothing about the SEPTA today, so, you know, you heard about it?
Yeah, I heard a little bit about it. But we walking. We usually take the bus up here, but today we had to walk because no bus is running right now.
There are no city buses, subways, or trolleys in operation at this time. The regional rail, suburban transit, paratransit, and Lucy lines are still running, but beware, they're expected to have some delays due to the increase in riders, and people are packed like sardines in train cars. Many commuters opted to drive into the city, making parking scarce on car-filled streets. The latest updates online, go to twitter.com/SEPTA. With Temple TV News, I'm Michelle Preventure.
Philadelphia's congested streets may be more than just a nuisance, but a safety hazard. And city officials say unruly bicyclists are in part to blame. Councilman Frank DiCicco and James Kenney introduced bills that would require bicycle registration and licenses and would increase penalties for running stop signs, sidewalk riding, riding while listening to headphones, and riding without brakes.
Cycling has really taken off in the city, and I think it's a good thing, and I think it's good for the environment, it's good for people's health, but we got to figure out a way to share our space. We need to have a discussion about how we share the same common space. So there's got to be some rules. I don't think you should be riding on the sidewalk. I just think it's dangerous. I think that I know I'm getting into this cultural clash with these fixed gear bikes, but I think a bike should have brakes. I mean, I might be really outlandish for me to think that, but I think bike should have, if it comes with a manufactured brake, don't take the brake off.
This comes on the heels of two separate bicyclist-pedestrian collisions, which occurred within a week of each other in October and left two men dead, 78-year-old Tom Archie and 40-year-old Andre Steed.
Drivers are rude. Pedestrians are absent-minded, and bikers can be rude and absent-minded too.
Some people, though, think bicyclists are being punished for not having a home. They're unwelcome to ride on sidewalks and unwelcome on the street. They think the legislation should address motorists who are unwilling to share the road and jaywalkers. Sarah Clark Stewart, the campaign director for the Bicycle Coalition of Greater Philadelphia, is one of the many who don't support the new bicycling bills.
The route of introducing legislation we called the wrong approach, because we don't think new laws or regulations are needed. What we think is needed to calm the city's streets is better enforcement of the current laws. The streets are very chaotic, and there's a lot of flagrant noncompliance with traffic laws. But it's not just bicyclists, it's pedestrians and motorists.
Shortly after the proposed bills came to light, the city's bike messengers held a rally during rush hour at 16th and JFK Boulevard. They were protesting what they call the rise of an anti-cycling climate.
Some of the reaction, I think, from some of the bike folks are a little over the top.
We work on our bikes. We ride on these streets every day, 40 hours a week, rain or shine. We're out here. And a lot of us, and I hear it over our radios, you know, I get the text messages from each other, I see what's going on the internet. A lot of us feel that there's been the rise of like an anti-cycling feeling in the city of Philly.
30-year-old bicycle courier Rachel Fletcher was hit by a car early Thanksgiving morning. Fletcher says she was yelled at by an angry driver before getting hit at 23rd and Locust Streets. Many fellow bike messengers are upset because despite the severity of the crash, police didn't file a report until 12 hours later. According to the U.S. Census Bureau, the number of Philadelphia bicycle commuters increased 76% between 1990 and 2006, and the number is steadily growing. There were nearly 600 bicyclists per hour crossing the five Schuylkill bridges during rush hour in 2008. Now, city officials and Bicycle Coalition representatives have agreed to meet with each other to discuss the bills, but they haven't set a date yet. With Temple TV News, I'm Michelle Preventure.
We want to be a drop-in third space for kids, like that's not their house, it's not their school, but it's where they go, where it's like the Cheers for kids, like, we know your name, we know your birthday, like, we love you, like, come and be with us. You find us, you get excited, you come in, you get your homework done, you read, you do experiments creatively.
Treehouse Books held a presentation of their student-made podcasts on Thursday evening. The after-school children's bookstore and study hall worked in partnership with Duckery Elementary School to create the podcasts. Kids interviewed friends, families, and neighbors in their North Central community.
My name is Vanetta. I am 13 years old. I have four brothers and two sisters. My sister Danietta, she listens to everything I tell her. I can tell her anything. We spend a lot of time together.
Creating a podcast is a great way to instill basic writing and analytical skills in a really innovative, creative way. And we're also teaching kids how to use technology.
I am so happy that I interviewed my mom because she is my inspiration. I want to continue sharing this with my mom.
Our first podcast workshops with kids came out of the Duckery School in-school workshop that we led. That was like spring semester of 2009. And then with the Sharif Street podcast, we did that as our first session of our summer camp. And then the last one we listened to, Don's Do Shop, is wildly in process currently. And it's, I mean, so we've been working on it for about 3 weeks.
Michelle Preventure, Philadelphia Neighborhoods, North Central.